So welcome everyone. As you see on the top, it's a Mentimeter presentation. Not all slides have questions, so keep focused on this on the main shared screen as well. But there are some questions that you can answer in a second screen or on your mobile device. The topic today is better animal research with FAIR data. Already many speakers have mentioned FAIR and FAIR data and explained it quite well, so that maybe we can keep it very short today. But nevertheless, I'll try to add something and add something about sharing as well, because FAIR is not only sharing, but we'll cover that a bit more. My name is Felix Weidemann. I work at the university library, mainly for the Faculty of Veterinary Medicine. But besides that, I'm involved in research data management and many other topics. I have to find out how to move to the next slide. Yes, so the planning today, some introductions. So I've introduced myself, but I do want to know who you are. So what's the audience today? It's FAIR. We can't skip it, but we'll cover the basics. Then data reuse. So what happens when you share data? And why is it useful to share data? So what are the benefits of sharing it? We'll have an example. And at the end, there's room for discussion. So of course, you can communicate before that, answering the questions, or use the chat, or raise a hand, or interrupt me. That's all fine. I would like to invite you to come up with more practical examples or issues from your field. So we can discuss that at the end and see if we make it till 4 or not. So your role in science, I've covered my own role, so I'm not a scientist. I'm more in the research support area. So if you can answer the question, log into Menti either on mobile or on another screen so that you can see where you are working. All right, so two people found the buttons. And if you're other, feel free to add it in the chat where you're from or how you would describe your role. So I'll wait a bit more because I see there's more participants than answers at the moment. But maybe people are fed up with Mentimeter. We're changing Mentimeter to a different system at the Utrecht University, but we can still use it, I think, for at least 1 month. So I see only two researchers. Only two, three. Okay, so this is again a workshop where the actual researchers are too busy to participate in these kind of workshops, and that I think that's typical, and that covers one of the issues we'll discuss later on. I'll have a look at the chat. I'm other academic, but I suppose a researcher at UU, a philosopher, but still a researcher. Yes. Yeah. So do you have the researcher mindset, or are you an actual researcher applying for funding? So, okay, thanks everyone for answering the questions here. Let me continue. This is about animal science, the laboratory animals, a very relevant topic in open science, as Frank Miedema already discussed. So I'm interested in, are you the actual animal handlers or not? All right, so some of you, like this month, never. So for myself, I do have a sort of an academic background, but not in animal science, but I did adopt two of the laboratory rats from Utrecht, so that now I do handle those, but at home in a nice, spacey living environment. All right, so some of you do work with animals in research. Thank you. This is about data. So your typical data set, if you're not an actual researcher, you'll think Think about an answer. What is your typical data set like? Is it terabytes, gigabytes, megabytes? Or is it a complete mystery and you just log in every morning into the cloud? It's not a mandatory question, and not everyone knows the average size of a data set. But as we saw, you have to fill in a data management plan. And one of the questions is about the size or the expected total size of your data set. So it's a relevant point, at least when it's terabytes. Then you need to prepare for a proper storage location. And you need to think about storing that for at least 10 years, as we heard is Utrecht University policy. So it's a few megabytes. There are no major issues in sharing it or keeping it or storing it on the long term. Gigabytes. Now, most systems don't care about gigabytes. But if it's a terabyte, you need to properly prepare for that, to store it, process it. And if you want to share terabytes online, you need a serious infrastructure to be able to do so. Another thing that comes back to the data management plan: what kind of data do you have? Mostly refer to digital data, but try to describe the type of data you process or collect in a few words. It doesn't have to be accurate. You can be creative or funny, but then I do get an idea of what kind of data you're working on with on a daily basis. It can be Excel sheets. It can be scans. It can be tissue, because all these types of data have different options to store and to share them, and different problems if it's sensitive data. All right, so you can add multiple answers. Excel, images, videos, spreadsheets, scans, flow cytometry, interviews. Yeah, so the biggest distinction in data types is whether it's sensitive data or non-sensitive data. Sensitive is often translated as to personal information. Most of the sensitive data is personal information, but you can think of other sensitivities, especially with animal research. It's heavily criticized, and maybe you don't want to share openly who's involved in research with animals and what kind of research there is. Excel sheets. Yes, there's still a lot of Excel sheets around. And also sensitive data can be commercial data from commercial parties. So if you work with people in the field, farmers, there can be commercial parties involved, and that make data sensitive and not able to share the data. Okay, this is a lot of sheets, as expected. So we heard the term FAIR already a few times, and I think Jeroen Geurts from Zonmw explained it pretty well, but I'm not sure if you remember. So there's three options. You heard about it before today, and you also already know what it means. You sort of know what it means. It's about open data, or you're still clueless. And this today was the first time you heard about FAIR data. All right, yeah, as an equal score, so no one is completely unaware of what FAIR data is or what FAIR data should be, but many of you think it's open data. Oh, still results coming in. 4 versus 5, yeah, so a bit more of you think it's open data. So FAIR, it's an acronym, it's the FAIR principles: findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And basically, findable means that people should be able to find your data somewhere, preferably online. Accessible, people should be able to find your data. And also, Jeroen Geurts mentioned that it should also be able for machines to find your data. I come back to that later, well, when we do dive into the each of the terms separately. But first, about the confusion between FAIR and open. Open data is data that can be used by anyone for any purpose. And There's a lot of examples of open data. Many of the municipalities have an open data platform. So the municipality of Utrecht has its open data all online. Amsterdam has its open data where you can look up anything related to the city. Most major cities have an open data platform. But FAIR data is something else. It's as open as possible and as closed as necessary, meaning that it shouldn't be all open, just download and get all the data. If there's personal information involved, you can still have a FAIR data set where the personal information is securely stored, archived somewhere, but you do open up the fact that you have a data set. So you publish a metadata file that says, we collected data, this kind of data, we answered these kind of research questions with this data. It's stored on our premises, but you do promote the fact that you have collected data. And if you see the figure on the bottom left, open data can be FAIR and FAIR data can be open, but it's not per se all FAIR data that is open. And why would we need this FAIR data? I think this visual illustrates it quite well. Interoperable, communicate with other machines, findable. And by doing this, you get the most out of your data. And it improves the reliability of your own studies, but also if all data is FAIR and collected in a proper way, it improves the reliability of research as a whole. And it will increase your visibility because you have not only a paper published, but also a data set published that can increase your visibility. And next to your paper, it can also attract new collaborations and partnerships. And it will enable others to answer their research questions with your data. So it's more efficient. And in the case of animal studies, you'll need less animals to answer the same amount of questions. So dive into the separate letters, the findable. Described well, so don't make typos as I did here. So describe it well with keywords, have a clear description and add a persistent identifier. Often that's a DOI, so the same identifier you find on a paper, you can also put on your data publication. Link your data publication to your paper and vice versa. So people finding your data can find your publication and the other way around. Use an ORCID, so if you're a data publisher, your name will be there with your ORCID. Everyone can link it back to you and your profile pages. And most of these points for findable can be covered if you use a repository. So there's Zenodo, there's Dataverse, Figshare, all kinds of systems that were mainly built to support FAIR data sharing. So by using one of those repositories, and at Utrecht we have our own Yoda repository, you already tick 90% of the boxes for all the FAIR characteristics. So accessible doesn't mean you have to open up everything, but you have to think about who should be able to access what parts of the data sets. So don't publish it behind the paywall or behind the login. If there's sensitive data involved, separate it or do anonymize the sensitive data. And again, use a repository because that facilitates downloading automatically by search engines or by people, or you can set up a restricted access with an option to give access to certain people after signing a data transfer agreement. And interoperable, I think this is the most complicated one. So interoperable meaning that anyone else opening up your data set understands what's inside the data set and what you did to collect the data, what's in those Excel sheets, what are the column names, and why is your column name, what's the standard in your column name. So the data set should be ideally self-explanatory. And ideally, it should not just be the data, but also your data and your code. So that anyone getting the data should be able to replicate the whole process of data analyzing. This is the most complicated one. Jacques also mentioned it in his talk that metadata should be all around and standards should be all around, but as this comic describes it quite well. So as the comic describes, the standards, there are many standards. But we're still looking for the one standard to rule them all. And since everyone thinks they have that, there's an abundance of standards that are used next to each other. I see a question in the chat. Do you also use the term tidy for automated data mining? I'm familiar with tidyverse, so to tidy up data sets. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, so I was told that data should be tidy with respect to the column naming and the way the data is made so that it can be automatically analyzed in R, for example. But I'm not sure if this one of the standards, tidy data?
Well, I think tidy data is just a description of a bit confusing, but yeah, fair data is exactly what that tries to get to data that is completely understandable for man and machine. By opening up an Excel sheet, there should be no confusion at all on the column names, or there should be an explanatory README file next to it.
So, I think that's, so fair data is automatically tidy data.
Yes, I think we can conclude that, but okay. Please, if someone wants to correct me. So tidy data is indeed data that, when opened by someone else, is self-explanatory. And reusable meaning that it should be clear for people finding out about your data set what they can and can't do with your data. And a proper license, either on a data set or on software, the Apache license is for software. Data and publications usually have a Creative Commons license. Solimay now also favors the CC BY license, meaning anyone can do anything with the data as long as they give you credit. So if they attribute the data to you. And of course, in science, when you start using data and don't explain where you got the data, it's quite close to fraud. So the CC BY shouldn't be needed. Everyone should explain how and where they got their data they are starting to reuse. I wanted to check whether you were aware about fair data again, but we have had a lot of fair data already, so I'll skip this one. So why is fair data in research, and why is everything centralized around this? And all major funders do that. That's because they see that fair data, so data that's easily exchangeable between researchers, that will increase the productivity of the researchers, and it will help forward science a lot faster. So you see all these four funders, their data management plans are centered around fair data. They all require you to open up your data as soon as you start the project. And remember that fair data doesn't mean you have to open up all of the data immediately, but just that you describe your data well and try to think ahead about reuse of your data, either by yourself in the next project or by colleagues in the next building or the next desk or anywhere on the world. So that's in short why there is so much around fair data and what fair data tries to accomplish. So when your data is fair, it doesn't mean that you're already sharing it. So you can have proper fair data set, reusable, but you'll just plan to use it yourself someday. So how do you feel about sharing the data that you collected? Are you in favor? Oh, we have a great first answer. I'll use the average that comes out later in this presentation. So if you don't agree with what's on the slide at this point, then try to influence the percentage here. But now I think I'll summarize it at around 95%. I'm not a data scientist, so I'm not sure if that's statistically a correct assumption, but Okay, so most of you are completely fine with sharing your own data, and also still most of you are completely fine with reusing data from others. So I'll set it at around 90%. So what are your reasons to share research data? Is that indeed in the benefit of science at large, or are there any other points that you say, well, I got benefits by sharing data? It's an open question. You can add multiple answers. To help science, yeah, I think maybe that covers everything. So yeah, my data was funded by public money, so it is publicly owned. Yes, citation advantage, increases group size. Yes. So about the publicly funding of the data. So I think legally all the data that you produce is owned by your employer. But in daily practice, it's still conceived as your data. So the Utrecht University as an employer not often enforces their right to own the data, but you're still responsible, of course, for all the data that you collect. To answer the research question, advance our understanding in certain areas, broaden the scope beyond my own expertise. Yeah. Well, thanks that are robust meta-analysis, yes. So these are the reasons to share and the reasons not to share. What's holding you back to share your data? Technical knowledge and time. Time and money, yes. Scooping, yes. I don't always own the data, yeah. Yeah, so if you have a combined data set, time. If you have a combined data set with external parties, commercial parties, or maybe competing researchers, you may not agree upon sharing everything. It can be complicated, but I think time, money, and yeah, effort. Authorship's also a good one. So can you be the author of a data set? Intellectual property, yes, okay. So you were a lot quicker with the reasons to share, but if I give it some time, then the reasons not to share are coming in. And I think time or effort or some risks are the central points in this for not sharing your data. So it's clear sharing data costs time, costs money, and it takes effort. So when will it pay off? So when is it successful? When do you say, well, I shared my data and it was worthwhile, it was worth the effort, worth the money, and worth the time? That's an open question. Use the chat or the microphone. So when will it pay off? So we'll look at an example next, but and people have looked at this, so when will it pay off? And yeah, the key answer here is it only pays off if your data set is being reused. So without reuse, then you have a fair data set that is findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. But if there's no reuse now or at any point, then the time and money and effort are, lost mostly. So that's, yeah, there you have to find a balance between spending time to verify and publish your data set. And on the other hand, you should encourage reuse of existing data sets. So currently the focus is still on a lot of producing new data sets. Of course, you want to explore new territories and do new new experiments and find out new stuff and set up your own design for an animal experiment. But that's in conflict with reusing data that is produced by others. I have a look at the chat. Used by other researchers. Yeah, that's indeed the main point. It pays off when it's reused. And verification is also important. Yeah, that's another point. Many of the time spent on verifying data sets is gained later on. So working in a fair data environment usually pays off in the end because it's much more efficient in the long run. So we get a lot of feedback from mostly PhD students who follow a course on FAIR data that they will apply this to their research data, but it will also help you in your daily life, keep your desktop a bit more clean and keep your mailbox a bit more clean. So FAIR data principles do not only apply to research data, but will make your daily data life also a bit easier and more efficient. Yes, it allows your article to be checked for quality. Yes, so that's next to sharing your data with others. You need to save your data for verification purposes. So that's the standard is 10 years. And more journals also demand that you publish your data before you submit the paper. So then your data needs to be somewhere online, enabling reviewers to verify your results with the data. So it differs per field how strict it is, but more and more journals do not accept submissions without a proper data publication next to it. But let's look at the data reuse. Let's look at an example. Well, I'll start by reusing data myself or data papers. A former colleague from the library, she created a model to test out what the costs and benefits are of data sharing and what variables are involved. There's two publications, one from 2015 and one from 2019, where she explores a model of the research world with researchers who write papers, who produce data, and who have the ability to share their data. And if they share their data, they will save time and write more papers. So of course it's a model, there's a lot of assumptions in there, but it still works, so you can influence the variables. And we're going to try to replicate the first study and see if we get the same results using this model. This is a part of the formula from the model, and give me 10 minutes to explain this formula. I'm not going to explain the formula. Luckily, there's a lot more a clear explanation in the paper as well. But for the people who want, you can dive into the formulas as well. It has a table with parameters and variables. I'm even not going to dive into each of them, but I want to highlight two of them. The TC, time cost to prepare a data set for sharing. And I've translated that to verify. So how much time is involved in making your dataset fair? Maybe to use a repository, to change your column names from my first variable one to something that looks like a standard column name. So how much time do you spend to make your dataset more fair and publish it online? And on the other hand, TR, the verify time. So how much time do you spend, given the fact that you stumble upon a dataset, and say, well, this looks actually really fitting to answer my research question, and I may consider using the data set instead of running my own experiment. And then you need time to verify this data set. And of course you see that the more time you spend to verify, the less time you need to verify. So these are two variables in this model that deliver in the end a balancing point or a cutoff point where the amount of reuse pays off. So all the variables in the system, some of them are fixed and some of them are variables, and you don't even need to read the full paper because there is a website linked to the paper. So the paper itself is in a data journal, and it comes with a Shiny app website where you can set your own variables. So let's try to, for animal research, or at least for people present today, fill in the variables and see where the cutoff point for reusing data set is in this field. So back to Mentimeter. So now we need the variables. How long will a data set be relevant? Of course, the time spent on verifying the data set, verifying, making it more fair and publishing it online. If your kind of data will be relevant for 60 years, there's a lot more chance of it being reused. Some fields, the discoveries go really, really fast, and you already know this research, it will be at least less relevant in 5 years. So for the researchers in the audience, do make a proper estimate on the relevance of your data set. And then on the middle row, how long does it take to generate a data set in days? And as I said, it's a model, there's variables, but it's fixed. So if it takes longer than 100 days, you can't go over 100 days. And how long does it take to write a paper? All right. I'll try to write it all down. So you can write a paper in 36 days after you've created your data set in 81 days. So it's changing. Please send in your votes, your final votes, because we'll use this to enter the model. And the next question is about verify an existing data set. So imagine you download a data set that looks promising, you open it up, it's in your field, but you need to maybe link it to your own data. And if it's ideally, you would spend only one day just extracting the data. And the second one is, how long will it take you to verify your data, so to make it ready to be shared? And this is in days, and the maximum here is 25 days. So it's assumed that it's yes, I see 14, 15.
Felix, I have a question here.
Yes.
Sometimes I can say skip and sometimes it's gone. Are you sure that when I don't skip explicitly because I don't do animal research that it's not counted as a zero? I'm not sure.
I'm not sure as well. I think I could, I think I gave everyone the option to skip answers. So you can, it will move to the next question if you skip it.
Okay, but the skipping was for, you know, it's what's differentiated. So I'm not sure I could skip all of them.
When you
submit, maybe it's only one skip that is submitted. Just to make sure.
I see you this. It's a bit difficult depending on the size of your screen to also navigate the days, but
okay.
I will publish the results, but I'll add a comment about this, of course, to keep it fair and verifiable. Okay, so I think we have five variables, and earlier you answered the question whether you're willing to share the data, and I summarized it at 90%. So I think we have sufficient input to start using the model. So the model is online with this link, and it should be online here as well. So this is the paper that explains this model, and this is the preliminary paper that introduces the game theory involved here. So this is the Shiny app. It will freeze after a while, but hopefully it will reload. And then on the left, we'll start with the data usability in years, and I wrote down 38, 39, 38, The time to generate a data set, that was quite long, I think 81. Writing a paper, 45 days. And this was the cost of reuse, 14 days. And the sharing costs, 15 days. And here the sharing researchers, in the earlier questions, you were quite positive about this. So this goes to 90. And we'll click this button, and then the model will calculate the minimum percentage of reuse needed to break even on sharing investment. So for a data set in this model with these parameters, it needs to be reused 0.53 times. Is that informative? Yes, to a certain extent. But it underlines the point that it only pays off if those data sets are reused. And you can use this model to see what helps, of course, to make the cutoff point shorter or to lower the minimum amount of reuse. And of course, there's a balance in sharing data. If you share a lot of data sets, the chance it will be reused is lower, at least given the same amount of reuse in the model. So to find the balance there, you have to promote reuse by others. You have to limit the time spent to verify data and verify data. I couldn't get two more clear words figured out. So if you want, you can train the model and you can say, well, what happens if generating a data set can be done in maybe 3 weeks? What happens? Then you'll see that the cutoff point, so the minimum percentage of reuse. I tried out everything, and let's see if it now it freezes. I'll try to reboot it once, and otherwise no, I think I have or everyone at home is also now testing the model from their own screens. Now it looks the model froze.